Hey guys, it's Maldworth, another stamp video. In the past 2 days, I've been going to the stamp show up in Itasca, suburb of Chicago. It was awesome, it was great. Saw a lot of people I had met the last time I went to a stamp show. Also made some new friends, interviewed some people about some stamps that they had they wanted to share with you guys. I also bought two pre-1950 stamp albums, international stamp albums that we're going to go through together in the next few videos. So these next few videos are going to be awesome. Definitely check them out when they pop up. Let's get into it. Hey, how you doing?
Okay, hi.
Awesome. So what's your name and what do you got for us today?
I'm Mike Homel. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan. My business name is Arbor Stamps, as you see by the sign up there on the top. And I'm a worldwide dealer. I started collecting when I was a kid, and then over the years, about 15 years ago, decided to buy and sell to collectors. And as I said, I'm worldwide, but let's just zero in on one example of stamps and how stamps tell folks about history of the world and connect to us. Awesome. And since we can't talk about everything at once, I'm going to pick a country in West Africa, Liberia. And the interesting thing about Liberia is it was founded by former slaves who came from the U.S. in the 1820s and 30s and 40s. And so they set up a separate country, which is called Liberia, probably after Liberty. And the country started issuing stamps about 1860, and it had a coat of arms that you see there on these stamps, and a slogan, "The love of liberty brought us here." Mm. So you have this, here, let me flip a couple other pages. So you had this country formed by Americans. They set up a country in West Africa. But it has a fascinating history, because while it was modeled after the U.S. with a stars and stripes flag, dollars and cents currency, and their capital is Monrovia, named after James Monroe, president of the United States in the 1820s. But there's conflict there between the Americo-Liberians, the folks who came from the U.S., and the indigenous people, who didn't want a bunch of people from the outside invading. So it was a history of over a century of conflict between the two. And that culminated, I think, around the 1970s or 80s, when the indigenous Liberians overthrew the government and slaughtered the president. And now, in the last, I don't know, 40 years or so, it's indigenous people. But Liberian stamps, you know, show the history of the country, the wild animals. There you go. This is like a late 19th century stamp, 1890s, you know, around then. And coat of arms. And here's another. Some stamps are overprinted with a new value, and that's that red bar there, overprinted. So another thing about Liberia is by the, let's say, around the 1890s, early 1900s, it became kind of a colony of Firestone rubber that had plantations and produced rubber for the emerging U.S. auto industry. So that's, you know, it shows you the kind of the indigenous people, indigenous birds down there, there again, yeah, African wildlife. So that always interested me as a kid. When I first heard about Liberia, it was founded by Americans, but it's in Africa. And how did that come about? So that's story of Liberia, and how stamps show the history of places, the natural features, and actually down below, we've got a set of stamps that came out probably around the late 1930s, 1940, that show the map of where it is in Africa. And so that's the example of stamps as a window to the world. Stamps let us know about the geography, about the history of places. Stamps, you know, some stamps are real cheap, a quarter, 50 cents. Some stamps are a lot of money, but you can do it on all kinds of levels. So that's the story of just one country and what stamps can tell.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Hey, how are you doing?
I'm doing just fine today, Daniel. Thanks.
So tell us your name and what you got for us today.
All right. My name is Al Delinco. This weekend, I'm working with Connoisseur Stamps and Collectibles here at the Chicago PEX show. I also run an eBay store under the name of B&D Stamp Corp. What I'm going to talk about today a little bit is how history and philately work together. And I'm going to talk very briefly about women on early U.S. postage stamps. Now, of course, we all know, or at least those who have been in the hobby know, that the very first officially United States postage stamp was issued in 1847. The 5-cent denomination depicted Benjamin Franklin. The 10-cent denomination depicted George Washington. And actually, it was several years before any person other than either Washington or Franklin appeared on a postage stamp. Took about 10 years or so. The next founding father to appear, or historical figure to appear, was Thomas Jefferson. Then slowly Abraham Lincoln, Andrew Jackson. But for the most part, for the early part of our history with postage stamps, there were only a handful of men who appeared on the stamps. In the late 1860s, we had the first pictorial issue of postage stamps, which had something other than the head of a human being on it, although Benjamin Franklin also appeared on the 1-cent pictorial. However, it wasn't until the 1890s, and specifically the Columbian Exposition issue of 1892, that we had a female of any kind appear on a U.S. postage stamp, and that was Queen Isabella of Spain, who appeared both in the vignettes, one or more of the vignettes, and then also on the $4 Columbian stamp, her portrait. She's actually the first female of any kind to have her portrait appear on a United States postage stamp, and that was again in the 1890s. It wasn't until 1901 and what we call the second bureau issue, which is what you are, you have your camera on now. This is a what we call a short set of the second bureaus. It's a complete set up to the 50 centers, although there is also a $1, a $2, and a $5 denomination for this set, which we don't have in front of us. But it wasn't until this issue in 1901, so 54 years after the issuance of the first United States postage stamp, that we had one that was basically to honor a woman. And that's the 8-cent denomination, which you can see has Martha Washington as the portrait figure on the stamp. So it took a long time to really get us a stamp that had a woman as the honoree on the stamp. I will tell you from personal preference, while this isn't necessarily the particularly the finest set of second bureaus, this happens to be, I think, one of the prettiest sets of stamps from early American philately. It's colorful. It has great detail and engraving on the stamps. The portraits are just first class, and you can see, you know, you've got Franklin, Washington, Jackson, Grant, Lincoln, Garfield on the top row, and you have Martha Washington. I believe the 10 is Daniel Webster, Benjamin Harrison on the 13, Henry Clay on the 15, and Thomas Jefferson on the 50. It's just a wonderful set of stamps. And the reason we call these the second bureaus, by the way, is that up until 1894, the United States government contracted out for the production of postage stamps. There were typically three private printers, the Continental Banknote Company, the National Banknote Company, and the American Banknote Company, that did all of the production of stamps. In 1894, the Bureau of Engraving and Printing began producing the stamps themselves, government effectively owning and operating the production operation. And this was the second set that they issued, and that's why we call these the second bureaus. It's a beautiful set of stamps. These are generally, at least the lower denominations, very affordable and easily obtainable for somebody who is just getting into collecting United States postage stamps. And again, I just think they have a tremendous eye appeal.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much.
You are very welcome, sir.